Our gracious Heavenly Father, we read in thy word, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess to God, and we believe that. Our Father, every person listening to this voice right now, one day, sometime, somewhere, out yonder in eternity will bow before God. Father, help me and help every person that listens to this voice today to recognize this Bible fact. Help us to know that God is love. God has done everything in his omnipotence. All that God could do, God has done to keep us out of hell. Help us, Father, to recognize and to realize that if we, who are created in the image of God, if we choose to follow sin, then our Father, help us to know that the wages of sin is death. Now, Father, take the word and honor the word, honor the blood, honor the name of Jesus, and save the soul that's nearest hell for Christ's sake. Amen. We're studying day by day the wrath of God, or sinners in the hands of an angry God. I'm using as a text, God judgeth the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all nations that forget God. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. As I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess to God. Our God is a consuming fire. I read Psalm 7:11, Psalm 9:17, Hebrews 10:31, Romans 14:11, and Hebrews 12:29. I was sitting here at my desk before the microphone, and down deep in my heart, something said to me, Brother Green, do you really believe what you're preaching? Preacher, do you really believe that God is angry with the wicked every day, and do you believe that sinners are roasting in the lake of fire? Or in the flame now. Do you really believe it? If you do, then prove it by the way you preach, by the way you live, and by the way you act. Now today, I want to talk to you right out of my heart, and I plead with you to hear me because I want to reason with you. I said on the last broadcast that a great host of old men, old women, young men, young women, and little children were pounding on the side of the ark, begging for entrance, and Noah could not let them in because God shut the door. You say, Brother Green, do you believe that God Almighty sent a flood and drowned little babies, little children, teenagers, young folks, granddaddies, great-granddaddies? Do you believe that? Well, I believe the Bible. Do you? You believe the Bible? I believe the Bible. You know, somebody wrote me the other day and said, Preacher, you take the Bible too literally. How else am I going to take it? I suppose you want me to preach that the flood was a symbol and symbolic, and it wasn't really a flood, and it wasn't really rain, and it wasn't really water, and folks didn't really drown. Is that what you want me to preach? Then if you want me to preach that, then the liberals come along and they say the blood's not really necessary, the virgin birth is not really necessary, and repentance is not really necessary. All you need is to be good and do good and live good, and everybody's good and God's good, so everything's all right. Now let me tell you something. It doesn't make any difference what people think about my preaching. Oh, I want you to love me. I want you to pray for me. I want you to be my friend. I don't want you to be my enemy. But when it comes to you criticizing my ministry and my preaching, it's not what you think about my preaching. It's what God Almighty thinks about it that matters. Now, I believe that God drove Adam and Eve out of the garden. I believe that God cursed Cain. And Cain cried out, my punishment is greater than I can bear. But God didn't take it away. God left it. I believe that God said, Noah, build an ark. And I believe God sent a flood. And I believe God drowned every human being on the face of the earth except Noah and his family. I tell you something else I believe. I believe Genesis 19. And to make a long, long story short, I want to tell the story up to the point that I want to begin reading. In Genesis 19, Lot, the nephew of Abraham, and Abraham was a godly man. By the way, let me stop just a moment, and let me go back and let me remind you of something. Adam and Eve were driven from the garden, but wait a minute, before God drove them from the garden, God gave them the right of choice. God told them what not to do, and God told them what to do, and they did what God told them not to do. And instead of calling on God, they set about to correct their own mistake. But God condemned their covering, and God provided coats of skins, and then God drove them from the garden. Now, Cain brought a bloodless offering, and God gave him the opportunity to bring a blood offering, but he refused. And he killed his brother, and he lied about it, and God cursed him. And he said, my punishment is greater than I can bear. But before God cursed him, God said, Cain, if you'll do right, I'll accept you. Now, God said, Noah, I'm going to send the flood, and you build an ark. And Noah built the ark, and he worked on it years and years and years. And every log he placed in that ark was a sermon, a testimony that a flood's coming. The folks had 120 years to repent. God's Spirit strove, and God's Spirit called, and God's Spirit convicted for 120 years. But not one person changed their mind about the judgment of God. Now listen, if you drop into the flames, it won't be God's will. It won't be God's desire. It'll be your stubborn will, and it'll be your own fruit. You'll eat of the fruit of your own way. In other words, God made you a free moral agent. You're not a puppet. You're not some kind of a mechanical device that God pushes around. God has given you the privilege to choose. Choose you this day whom you will serve, and you will not come to me that you might have life. It's not God's will that any perish. It's God's will that all come to repentance. And if you drop into hell, it won't be God's will. It'll be your stubborn, rebellious will. All right, now I want to read on just a little bit here. Now, Sodom and Gomorrah had become so wicked and so vile and so ungodly that the wickedness of the city reached, that is, the nostrils of God, and God said, we'll have to do something about it. Now remember, Lot was the nephew of the friend of God. Lot was exposed to the right. Lot knew the right, and Lot knew that Father Abraham feared God. But when Lot moved to Sodom, he backslid. He followed the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the habits of Sodom. In Genesis 19 and verse 12, the men said to Lot, hast thou any here besides son-in-law, thy sons, thy daughters, and whatsoever thou hast in the city, bring them out of this place, for we will destroy this place, because the cry of them is waxen great before the face of the Lord, and the Lord hath sent us to destroy it. You say, Brother Green, do you believe that there was a city, a literal city, named Sodom and one named Gomorrah? I certainly do. I certainly do. You say, Preacher, you're narrow. Well, I'm glad I am. I'm glad I'm narrow. I believe in the old-time religion, old-time Bible, old-time preaching. And that's the only kind I'm going to preach. And when he gets to the place, can't preach that, I won't be a hypocrite. I won't preach anything if I can't preach the truth and the Bible. Yes, there was a city named Sodom, and Lot sat in the gate. He was the ruler. He was the mayor of the town. He had one prominence, and he had one a place of authority in the city of Sodom. And he mixed and mingled with men of sin and ungodliness and unrighteousness. So, we find in verse 14, Lot went out and spake unto his sons-in-law, which married his daughters, and he said, Up, get you out of this place, for the Lord will destroy this city. The Lord will destroy this city. But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, Arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters, which are here, lest thou be consumed, get it, in the iniquity of the city. Lot, get out, hurry, hasten, move on, lest you be consumed in the iniquity of the city. Now, in Genesis 19:16, while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand and upon the hand of his two daughters, and the Lord being merciful unto him, and they brought him forth and set him without the city. And it came to pass, when they had brought them forth abroad, that he said, Escape for thy life, look not behind thee. Don't look behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain, escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. And Lot said unto them, Oh, not so, my Lord. Now, to save time, read verse 22. I'm skipping down to verse 22. Haste thee, escape hither, for I cannot do anything till thou be come thither. Therefore, the name of the city was called Zoar. Now, watch verse 23. The sun was risen upon the earth when Lot entered into Zoar. The Lord, watch it now. Genesis 19:24. Then the Lord rained upon Sodom and Gomorrah brimstone and fire. The Lord rained upon Sodom and Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the plain, and all the inhabitants of the cities, and that which grew upon the ground. But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. Now, beloved, it may be hard for you to believe what I've read. It may be hard for you to believe it. It may be hard for you to accept it. But there's one thing you must do. You must accept it or reject it. And if you reject it, you're rejecting God's word. And to reject God's word is to invite God's wrath to fall upon you. Now here's the picture. Lot was reared under the influence of godly Abraham. Lot knew the right. He knew what was right. He knew what was wrong. And when it was left up to him to take the plains, to take the ground he wanted, he took the plain and he pitched his tent toward Sodom. He moved to Sodom. He began to make money. He began to become prominent. He forgot God. He forgot righteousness. He backslid. He went after the things of the world. And he became one of the Sodomites. He rubbed shoulders with them. He lived with them. He ate with them. He fellowshipped with them. And he sat in the gate of the city at evening. And God sent two men down and said, Lot, if you have anybody in this town that you love, get them out. God sent us down here to burn this thing to the ground. Lot believed it. Lot knew that God would do it. Lot knew enough about God to know that God is a consuming fire. But I'll tell you today, brother, you don't hear much about God Almighty being a consuming fire. No, you don't. No, you don't. It's love. It's love. It's tenderness. It's tenderness. The fatherhood of God. The brotherhood of man. Everybody's good. Nobody's bad. A loving God wouldn't permit a man to burn in hell. Wait a minute. Just a minute. This old book got here before that crowd did. It'll be here when that crowd's gone. God doesn't want men to burn in hell. It's not God's will that men burn in hell. It's God's will to save whosoever. It's God's will to save all. It's not God's will that any perish, but that all come to repentance. But if people refuse to serve God and refuse to live for Jesus, if they choose to serve sin and the devil, then God has no alternative. He said, I called and you refused. I stretched out my hand. You regarded it not. You said it not, my counsel. You would not listen to my reproof. I will therefore laugh at your calamity, and I'll mock when fear comes upon you. Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat of the good land. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured by the sword. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So I warn you, my dear friend by the radio, I warn you. God loves you. But God Almighty will not allow you to serve the devil and ignore Jesus, to serve sin and ignore righteousness, to follow the world and ignore the Holy Spirit's calling and get away with it. Just as sure as you're listening to my voice, if you follow sin, if you follow the world, if you follow lust, you'll reap the wages. The wages of sin is death. Now, I believe it because the Bible teaches it. If the Bible didn't teach it, I wouldn't believe it. Every person, all the daddies, all the mothers, all the granddaddies, all the grandmothers, all the babies, all the little children, all the teenagers, all the young people in Sodom and Gomorrah were burned to ashes. Their bodies were burned to ashes. All were destroyed except Lot, his two daughters, and his wife. Now, of course, the wife looked back. God said, don't look back, don't look back. So she disobeyed God, and she turned to a pillar of salt. Now, the thing that I want to drive home today as I close this broadcast is the fact that Lot was spared because Lot was a righteous man. You say, preacher, do you mean to tell me that you believe Lot went to paradise or to heaven? Yes, I certainly do. Now, in 2 Peter chapter 2, I read the text that I read the first day of the series. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them in the chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that afterward shall live ungodly. Now here's the verse, 2 Peter 2:7, and delivered just Lot. God delivered just Lot. Vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelleth among them, in seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. For the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Now, the reason Lot escaped with his life and was not burned to ashes with the rest of them, he believed God. Now, just a minute. He believed God. All right. He was sitting in the gate. Two men came and said, Lot, God said for us to tell you, if you have anybody in here or anything in here that you love, get it out. God sent us down here to destroy the place. Now, immediately, Lot began to attempt to get his loved ones to leave. But they thought he was acting crazy. They said, you act like a madman. You talk like a madman. You talk like a crazy man. And after all of the pleading, the men took Lot and his wife and his daughters by the hand and literally carried them out of the city. And when Lot was on the outside, God sent down fire and brimstone and burn those two cities into ashes. The reason Lot got out, he was God's child. He was righteous. And the only way to become righteous is to be covered by the blood. That is to believe on the Lamb, to believe in the Lamb, to believe in the blood sacrifice. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Without the shedding of blood, there is no cleansing. Lot was a righteous man. That's the reason he got out. And if you're born again, the judgment of God will not fall upon you. But if you're not born again, I warn you, one of these days, the judgment of Almighty God will be your portion. He that believeth on him is not condemned. He that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. If you're not a believer, I beg you to bow your head and shut your eyes and call on God this very moment. God will save you if you'll call on Jesus' name and put your faith in his shed blood. Father, honor the word, honor the name of Jesus. Save the soul that's nearest hell. For Christ's sake, we ask it. Amen.